Please register. Now, we talked about Schrodinger equation last time, right? So what is Schrodinger equation? You start with I h bar, partial psi, partial t equal to h psi. This is Newton's law in quantum mechanics. You don't ask why. You only say that it makes sense and it works. You cannot prove it, right? From more fundamental theory. Then we say psi is a vector because we're talking about qubit. So it must be a linear combination of alpha and of 0 and 1 with coefficient alpha and beta. That's why we write it's alpha beta, right? Hamiltonian is the matrix or the operator, right? So now you just say that will we get something like the simple harmonic oscillator? Of course, if you have a form like this, h equals to 1 over two mv square, maybe minus kx, right? You have a form like this, then your solution will be a simple harmonic oscillator. And that is exactly what you have, for example, in superconducting qubit. We are all doing the simple harmonic oscillator, and then you get two levels, right? But we don't do this. This is a lot of, excuse me. This is not the right form. We need to transform into the canonical form, right? We use the P, the momentum, and the displacement, right? So maybe I should call plus Kx, right? This become P squared divided by 2m plus Kx. And here you will start have this P and X are two operator. They don't commute with each other, and they cannot be measured exactly at the same time due to Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Then in any system, you also have this type of conjugated pair. And that's why you can reuse this theory. It may be the, I think it's the number of the Cooper pair versus the phase, they are conjugated pair, but they will follow something similar. Okay, so we'll cover E274 in that pace, right? But the important thing is we do have an Hamiltonian. Here we don't say what it is. This is the energy, right, of the whole system. The landscape determine how the state evolve. Okay. Now, so in a quantum computer, what we are doing is to find the or set up the correct H, right? Just like what I said, I have the state. I have a ball on this table. I try to tilt this table. I can tilt, make the ball fall to the left or throw to the left or throw to the right. Right? Depends on how I tune it. And this is the Hamiltonian I set up for this system, right? And then I can do the quantum computation. So the Hamiltonian in general, of course, it is the Hamiltonian for all the Hamiltonian applied to individual qubit, and the Hamiltonian applied to interact with the qubit, right? So Hi affects qubit I, and we know that, right, you can do many things, but it must be a 2x2 matrix because it's a 1-qubit system, right? I mean, it's a qubit. It's not, it only has two level, right? It only is 2x2. You only have two basis states, right? So we call it sigma A. Now, that way we call it sigma because it can be a linear combination of the Pauli matrix and also identity matrix, right? I think we talked about this earlier. We showed that any unitary matrix is a linear combination of the Pauli matrix and identity matrix. I hope I'm right, but we talked about that earlier, right? And this is the something I apply to the system, and I can decide how strong I want to apply, right? This is just a scalar. Okay, 0.1, 0.2, or 0. When it is 0, it means I'm not applying anything. It's just like a filter. It's just like this. This is HA. Is this okay for this part? Right? And then we also can have Hamiltonian to control two qubits at the same time. Of course, that we need to harvest the physics, right? For example, later you see that in a neutral ion qubit, a neutral atom qubit, right? You will excite them to so-called ripple state, so they can be very large and they will start interacting, And now you can apply some energy so that this one will affect them at the same time. But how you affect it depends on the state of the other. Then you get a control NOT gate, right? And again, you have this U, which is the strength, just saying that when I'm going to turn it on and off, right? Here I have two operators, sigma A, sigma B, applied to individual qubit. So this is a tensor product of, okay. Now, but we are not going to go here. We'll just concentrate on the one qubit. Yeah.
So in the
okay, you are talking about what are the units, right? So first of all, I say H is Hamiltonian, right? I say what is this? This is related to what? Total energy. So on the right side, looks like it is the total energy, right? Then on the left must be the total energy also. And then you look at this, what is H bar? H bar is EV per EV second, right? I forgot. Yeah, I think EV second. I know it's EV second because here I have second, so they got canceled. Yeah, so the unit is energy on left and right. Right, this wave function is just numbers, right? Okay. Yeah, I think so. You can anything with respect to time, right? You can have unit respect to time, voltage per second or per second is okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So
the second unit is that refers specifically to entanglement. We don't call it entanglement, what we said interaction between qubits. It might not entangle in some sense, right? If you only have two qubits, they doesn't necessarily result in entanglement. But yeah, it's necessary for them to get entanglement for the second part.
So if you wanted to, let's say, model interaction for the qubit, let's say with the environment, you just have another graph into that.
Oh, this is, I'm not prepared for that, but you actually, you need something called dissipative energy, right? With the environment, because you're going to lose something. Here, it is as a conservative, right? No matter how you do, the total energy is still the same. Yeah, so I believe, yes, you add a dissipative term to it. Usually it's gamma, and then you will see the gamma will appear in your final solution, and you will see that how it decay. Yeah, but what I'm saying might not be 100% accurate, but we will talk about that in the 274. I will study before I teach that. Okay, good. But the most important thing is now. I don't think I want you to memorize Schrodinger equation. The most important goal is I hope you always remember. You look at it, you get familiar with it, you are not afraid of it. Right? Many of us see something like this or some more complicated equation, we're afraid of that, then we don't want to continue. I think you need to change this psychology, no matter what you're going to do in the future. You might not be the engineering field. Just get familiar with it. Always we're scared of something is because we are not familiar with it. Really. Yeah. You might be scared of your girlfriend or boyfriend's family because you don't know them well. Once you have a dinner, you feel that, oh, good. Actually, I'm not scared. Yeah. That's the fact, right? So do this. That's first thing, because you can always Google. Second thing, of course, I really want you to appreciate that. Yeah, it is a rate of change on the left and then energy times the state on the right. And the last thing, the most important thing is you need to understand that this equation is determine how the alpha and beta change, right? Partial alpha, when you do the partial psi, partial t, you are basically doing the partial alpha, partial t, partial beta, partial t individually. And then you set up the equation, right? And that is why we had this in the last slide, from last time. So we start with this one. I will spend more time to explain, right? So we start with this one. And we say, okay, this is the Schrodinger equation. IH bar partial psi partial t equal to H psi, right? So this is a form, right? It's just nice, a state But we need to represent the state. We need to spell out, right? What is the state? So we decided to find a basis to represent it, right? Remember, just like the egg I bought, I say I bought 12, 1 egg, or I bought 1 dozen of egg, right? Now I need to decide what I want to write, whether I want to write 12 or 1, right? So I say, okay, let me just pick the basis 0 and 1 to describe this state because I need to do operation. You can pick plus minus. You can pick whatever, happy and sad. As long as you are consistent, that is okay, right? So now I pick 0 and 1. Okay, then I just remind myself partial psi, partial t is just partial alpha, partial t, 0, plus partial beta, partial t, 1. Is this okay? Yeah, because that is psi, right? 1 is the basis state. You don't change it. It's a constant, right? So you apply the partial derivative. It's still there. Then I just substitute it, right? So I do I, h bar, I substitute this whole thing to here. I get this, and then h, substitute this whole thing, right? And then now I apply the trick we use a lot in quantum mechanics, right? In solid state physics or linear system of equation. I just apply the k from the left to do an inner product. The goal is to cancel out something, right? Apply the k from the left, what will you get? Again, this is bra. So you think about in the matrix form, it's just a row vector. When I see h bar, partial alpha, partial t, they're just numbers. I can take it out, right? That's why I take out I, h bar, partial alpha, partial t. And then I have this k inner product with 0. Same here, k inner product with 1. On the right, I need to do the same thing. Alpha k inner product with k with h 0, beta k inner product with h 1. Is this okay? Any questions? These are all the rules that we learned before, right? In the Hilbert space. That's good, right? So if this is okay, then we look at case by case. What if k is 0? Okay, if it is 0, 0 inner product with 0 is what? 1, right? Because it's orthonormal. 0 inner product with 1 is what? 0. So this is gone. So I only have I h bar partial alpha partial t, right? And then on the other side, I cannot do cancel anything. But remember, what is kh 0 for any matrix you represent in the basis? Its element, the ith row and jth column, it can be found by this I h bar sandwich, I h j sandwich, right? So I won't remind you again, but you go back to my previous video and slide. We talk about this. I show you that this is correct. And after all, once you trust that it's correct, memorize it, right? You know that this is correct. Otherwise, every time you see this, you will get nervous again and spend too much effort in thinking about this instead of looking at the big picture. So trust me, this is correct, and we proved that earlier. Okay, so the ith row, right, let me remind you, this is the ith row, jth column. Element of H is I, H, J, this sandwich. Okay, so based on this, then 0, H, 0, of course, is the H, 0, 0. 0, H, 1 is H, 0, 1, right? So the first equation, when K is 0, give me I, H bar partial alpha partial T equal to this term. Basically, what it's telling me, it's telling me how the alpha evolved with time, right? Partial alpha is the change rate of alpha, which is the coefficient of 0. How it changes with time is proportional to alpha times the Hamiltonian's first row, first column element, and plus beta times the Hamiltonian's first row, second column element. These are just numbers. Okay, these are just numbers. Make sense? I'm saying this is a scalar. Do you agree? Is this a scalar vector or matrix? Scalar, right? Because H00, H01 are the elements in the matrix. Okay? I do the same thing for K equal to 1. Then this 0 term is gone. I only have this beta left, partial beta, partial T. Then I have this one, right? If you observe this, you find that this is just a matrix equation like this. I can show you. I wrote it down. Let me show you this is correct. Because the first row, ih power partial alpha partial t equals to 0, 0 times alpha plus 0, 1 times beta. The second row, ih bar partial beta partial t equals to 0, 1, 0 times alpha times h1, 1 times beta. These two are equivalent. Okay? So basically, it's saying that if you want to know how the states evolve, and the state is completely determined by alpha and beta, then you know that the alpha and beta are just related to the rates of change, just related to the original alpha and beta by this matrix. That's all I want to say. And I don't require you to understand this skill, to be able to use this skill in your exam from scratch. Of course, you need to understand the basic thing like the inner products, right? But all I wanted to just show you that this is a very useful skill. If you have taken solid state physics, calculate the band structure or whatever, this is the skill used very often to find out the matrix element. Okay. Yeah.
Can H be measured?
H, can it be measured? What is A? H is the Hamiltonian, right? So you can measure what? The eigenvalue of it, right? Because that's measurable, that's observable. And once you measure the eigenvalue, then of course you can transform it to any basis state, then that is the whole matrix. Now the 0 and 1 might not be the eigen basis of H. So this is not diagonal, might not be diagonal. Do you see what I mean? Yeah. Okay, so let's take a look at an example of a rotation. Now, what if I have this Hamiltonian, H equals to negative Hz sigma z? Again, what is Hz? Is it a vector, scalar, or matrix? As I mentioned to you earlier. Maybe you forgot, right? Let's, huh? Say again? Yeah, that's what I'm asking you. So you say it is a scalar, right? Yeah, it's a scalar. That is by definition here. Do you see that? Yeah. If just give you this equation, it can be a matrix also. We have matrix times matrix equal to matrix. Same as this is a matrix, but matrix times matrix still a matrix, right? Yes, it can be a vector. But most importantly, I want to ask you to recall what I just told you. The Hamiltonian is represented as H times sigma A. So this one is a scalar. It's talking about when I turn on the pulse. Okay, so you're right, it's a scalar, yeah? So what is that? You know how to put it in a matrix, what is that? Hz, what is sigma z? 1, 0, 0, minus 1, right? So this is negative Hz, 0, 0, negative, positive, thank you, Hz. That is the Hamiltonian. It can be so simple, right? It's not a monster, and it's very easy with qubit. And you say if you can measure, yeah, it's diagonal. If you measure it, that is just the energy. Okay, now that is the Hz. So how does it evolve? If I have a state, a general state psi equal to alpha 0 plus beta 1. Well, I just followed the equation I derived earlier. We already know that what is partial alpha? Partial t is equal to 1 over I h bar alpha h 0 0 plus beta h 0 1. If you don't trust me, take a look at one more time. I h bar, look at this equation. I h bar partial alpha partial t equal to alpha h 0 0 plus beta h 0 1. Yeah. Yeah. No, so this h actually includes, is a function, I should really write it as this, hz of t. So it includes all the height and also the width. Or even you can have multiple pulse. Okay, it's good. No, so yeah, he said that we need to have this to be normalized. I don't see that. It need to be unitary. Oh yeah, normalized, yeah. This is a little bit tricky. Then we will just turn it on and off, one and zero, right? Then that will make more sense, right? You don't do 0.1. Maybe I was wrong. I cannot say 0.1 to 0.5. But not really. Yeah, that is for the qubits, right? But in general, you don't. I don't think you need to be unitary. I need to think about that, right? Because of course I can still manipulate a qubit by full pulse or half pulse, right? The physics is still there, right?
My thoughts are maybe that's
actually I take it back. This one can be, I think it can be any number, because this is not talking about the multiplication of the gates. We're talking about the evolution in the equation, right? Because it's not h times this one times the date state becomes the next state. This one is only talking about the rate of change. Do you see what I mean? If this, I say psi final equal h times psi initial, then this needs to be unitary. But this is not psi final. This is the rate of change equal to h times the initial. You see? So it doesn't have to be unitary. Yeah. Okay. So that's good, right? I may not answer perfectly, but that's a very good thought, right? Because you think in this way, then you realize you understand the equation better, right? Now we're talking about the rate of change equal to this. Okay? Now, so based on this, I can have this equation, right? I already show you this is correct. I just move the IH bar to here. So what is this? Can you substitute and find out what is this on the right-hand side? What is H00? Minor HZ, yes. What is H01? H01. Zero. Very good. Yeah, it can trick you. If it is H, you see, then this equation will be very complicated, which is possible because you have coupling, more coupling. Here you basically don't have coupling. So this one you get negative Hz alpha divided by IH bar. Okay? So you have partial alpha partial t equal to a constant times alpha. So what is the solution? Alpha equal to alpha zero exponential negative h bar z alpha. No, I don't have alpha anymore. H bar z divided by I h bar t. Is that okay? Just a differential equation, right? D alpha dt equal to alpha times a constant. Then the solution is e to the power that constant times t. Yeah. If you don't trust me, just substitute. Do a differentiation, you get it, right? So you see the alpha changes exponentially, but remember this is a complex number, so it's oscillating, right? So we get this, maybe I should rewrite it as with the I on the top. If that is the case, I have no H bar Z, right? I keep writing wrong thing. HZ is HC. Okay, right? So alpha equal to the initial alpha, alpha naught times exponential I to the power hc divided by h bar t. Okay? Similarly, maybe you can try it yourself. Beta is the same, equals to beta zero, but exponential negative I h bar hc. Divided by h bar t. Why I have a negative here? Because for beta, we are doing hc, right? It's h10 and h11, right? And that's why I get hc, right? Is that okay? So you give me this rotation matrix now, I can find out how the alpha and beta changes. Is okay, all the people over that corner? Yeah, question? What, where, this part? This one? Final solution?
Yeah.
What happened to the minus signs? Because I bring the I to the top, right? So negative one divided by I equal to I, yeah, good. Okay, so let's try to correlate this to the Brock sphere. I know how the alpha beta changes. Let's recall, what is alpha? We say alpha zero equals to cosine theta divided by two, e to the power negative I phi divided by two. Do you remember this? That is alpha. Maybe you forgot, right? Yeah. What is a general state? General state is alpha 0 plus beta 1, right? And we can also write it as cosine theta divided by 2 e to the power I phi divided by 2 0 plus sine theta divided by 2 e to the power, this is negative, I phi divided by 2 1. Remember this? I just mentioned at the beginning of the class. Yeah, when we met to the Brock sphere, right? Theta is the polar angle, psi is the azimuthal angle. Okay, so that's why I say alpha zero at the beginning is just equal to cosine theta divided by two e to the power negative I phi divided by two, right? Now, based on this, how does it change? It only changed alpha by changing the phi, right? Do you see that? Instead of alpha, it becomes alpha zero times exponential I h z divided by h bar t, right? Because alpha zero was the initial one, whatever you are, wherever you are, theta and phi. Now I have this exponential, right? After this operation, after this Hamiltonian operation, it becomes this, right? So how do I write this? Isn't this equal to cosine theta divided by 2 e to the power negative I divided by 2 phi minus h 2hz divided by h bar t, I mean not t. So what I'm doing here is this. I have alpha has the e to the power negative I phi divided by 2. And then it becomes this one times this one. I just combine them, right? So I take out negative I phi I divided by 2. So I have the phi left. And I take out negative I divided by 2. So this becomes negative and becomes 2hz because I don't have 2 here. Ht. Or if it's this confusing, expand this one. This one equal to what? E to the power negative I phi divided by 2, which is this term, times positive 2 cancel I hc divided by h bar t, which is this term. I'll give you 1 minute. Think about that. And what I'm saying is that this was the original state after I've applied the Hamiltonian, right? It becomes original state times this extra phase. That's what I'm showing here times this extra phase, right? So the new state is still have the same polar angle, theta, but it rotated clockwise by this angle for alpha. Is it the same for beta? Let's check. Beta zero was sine theta divided by 2 e to the power I phi divided by 2, right? After I've applied the Hamiltonian, it becomes beta zero exponential negative I h z divided by h bar t because of this one, right? Let me also erase this. Correct? So if I try to spell it out, psi is still the same psi theta divided by 2, but this becomes I divided by 2. The first term is phi. The second term is negative 2hz h bar times t. Right? Again, expand it. First term e to the power I divided by 2 phi. Second term negative 2 cancel I hz divided by h bar t. So if you look at this, this is a new state because alpha and beta is the new states, right? Of the after your state rotates or manipulated by the Hamiltonian. It tells us that in the new state, theta is the same. The polar angle is the same. But the phi is what? Wherever you are, it's going to rotate counterclockwise by 2hz divided by h bar t. Clockwise, not counterclockwise, right? Rotating in this direction on the equator. Make sense? Because this is the new angle. It was phi, but now you subtract by angle. That angle is 2hz divided by h bar t. Right, so let me summarize in one statement, right? After applying H, which is negative HC sigma Z by T time for that law, the state rotates about Z-axis by, I forgot also, H2HZ divided by H bar T angle. Okay? That's what it does. Now, if I set the strength for my magnetic field and the time such that negative 2hz divided by h bar t equal to pi. What happened? You rotate it by pi about z, right? What is this gate? I apply this 2hz h bar, right? This time and this Hamiltonian, it rotate by this angle, right? If I set this whole thing equal to pi, then it's basically saying that I rotate it by pi. It doesn't matter where it starts, where it ends up. Yeah. We just call it the C gate. Yeah, you can say, because going another side is the same as the forward, right? I mean, just to tell you, there is a way you can create a Z gate. Do you see that? All you need to do is you are able to create this Hamiltonian. Then I can apply a Z gate to the state. Yeah? And you say, where does it start? Doesn't matter because Z gate should apply to any state. And one special state is plus. You apply the Z gate, then it becomes minus. Right? Because a Z gate in the plus minus basis is actually a NOT gate. Yeah.
They have to be in order for it to cycle, but it have to be self-defined. It's like a sinusoidal wave, but I'm like, no, because you continue to ramp it higher. And you know that it just that phase, so you could continue to give it to rotate.
I don't get it.
Remember, I was going to say it doesn't mean, I asked earlier, agency has to be a sinusoidal waveform. If you everything normalized,
HC is not sinusoidal. As I said, no, you don't.
Hey, still working out because even if you're rotating itself up to 20 degrees, that's just bringing it back to zero.
It's the result of rotation, is the result, right?
Yeah.
But this is nothing to do with the rotation as an input. Okay. Yeah. And the reason you want sinusoidal because you want it to be normalized. You keep thinking about normalization, right? But again, I say we don't need to have a unitary matrix here because this is not a gate multiplication. We are not going to have this equation is not final state equal to h times the initial state. That you need to be unitary. This is just saying that the rates of change equal to this times size. So h itself is not the okay, so maybe the confusing part is H itself is not the gate as the quantum computing gate algorithmically that we are talking about. It does difference, it's a physical gate doing something, but it's not directly mapped to the quantum computing gate that we have been talking about. It's related, right? And you see that definitely the okay, good. Okay, so now